this tutorial, we're going to make this gorgeous Fair Isle hat. It's called the Baa-ble Hat, and it was designed by Donna Smith as the official pattern for the 2015 Shetland Wool Week. It's an extremely popular design with over 4,000 projects of it on Ravelry. It's a quick and very enjoyable pattern, which makes it an ideal introduction to the Fair Isle or Stranded technique. The Baa-ble Hat is a free pattern, and I've included a link below where you can download the pattern, but you first have to sign up for the Shetland Wool Week newsletter. The pattern is written for an Aran or worsted weight yarn, and I'm using the Rowan Hemp Tweed. And the Rowan Hemp Tweed is a blend of 75% wool and 25% hemp. Hemp fibre is resistant to stretching, so it doesn't distort with use and naturally softens with wear. So it's a really lovely yarn to use for a hat. I'm following some modifications from the original pattern. The modifications were written by a really great knitting blogger that many of you may already know, and that's Susan B. Anderson. So some knitters were finding it difficult to get the rather tight gauge that the original pattern suggests, and their hats were turning out just a little larger than what they were wanting. So Susan B. Anderson's modifications counteract that by cutting out half a pattern repeat. So I'm going to include a link to her blog where you can get a copy of her modifications if you're interested in doing so. Because this design is such a wonderful pattern, as is proven by how popular it is, and it makes such a really cute gift for adults or children. And I know you'll have a lot of fun picking the different contrasting colours. So in this video, I'm going to take you step by step through the construction of the hat. I'll be showing you how to knit the two-handed Fair Isle or Stranded technique, and how to catch your floats and weave the ends in as you go. So if you're confident in knitting in the round and you would like to try the two-handed Fair Isle or Stranded knitting technique, then this is really the perfect pattern for you to learn this, and I want to encourage you to follow along with me. If at any time you wish to go directly to a new section in this video, I have links to the different sections in the program notes so that you can do that. So get a copy of the free pattern from the link below and get your yarn. I've also included a link to the yarn that I'm using. Have a look at Susan B. Anderson's modifications if you're interested in doing so. There's also a link to her wonderful blog below. And then please join me in the next section where we're going to be casting on together. So achieving the correct gauge is extremely important for this hat. And as you know, I'm following the modifications by Susan B. Anderson, and she suggests getting a gauge of 18 stitches per 10 centimetres. So I'm using, my wool is the Rowan Hemp Tweed, and they suggest the recommended gauge for this wool is 19 stitches. So that's for 10 centimetres. That's close enough. So I have knitted my gauge swatch, and please, I really recommend you do that as well. And I'm going to show you how to measure it. So when you're knitting a gauge swatch and you want to have 18 stitches for 10 centimetres, cast on some extra stitches on either side so that you're measuring inside from the edges. This way you'll get a more accurate measurement. So I've put my first needle in, and you'll notice you've got columns of knit stitches. And a knit stitch is like a V, like this. So I've put my first needle in to the left of one of those columns, and then I put my tape measure there, line it up, lay it across, and put my second pin exactly where the 10 is. This is a very well-loved tape measure, so you can't actually see or read the numbers there, but I know that that's 10. Okay, so just in case you've never done a gauge swatch before and you're unsure of how to counting, I'll show you. So you've got your columns of V's like this, and that's what you're going to count. So there's the first one. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, and 18. Okay, so my gauge is spot on, and that's great. If it's 18 and a half, you're probably okay, or 17 and a half, it's probably even better, because for stranded knitting, it tends to pull in a little bit more. So you want to bear that in mind. Okay, I achieved this gauge with a 4.5 millimeter needle, and that's what I'll be knitting the bulk of the hat on. And I will choose a 4 millimeter needle to do the ribbing, which I'll show you now. So Susan's modifications, she says to cast on 88 stitches once you've got a gauge of 18 stitches for 10 centimetres. So we're going to use the long tail method of casting on, and I'm going to show you how to do this in magic loop. So you can use double pointed needles, or you can use a very long cable needle like this, and the measurement of mine is 100 centimetres from the outer edge point of one needle to the other. And so this is what I'm going to use. Now, I've already cast on most of my stitches. I'm just going to cast on the last 5 stitches, and I'll show you how to do that. So we have the tail. This is the tail. And then we have the working yarn, which is attached to the ball of wool. So we have the working yarn tensioned in our right hand, and the tail we have in our left hand. I'm going to hold the tail like this, put my thumb over the top and down and under so that the wool has gone round my thumb. I'll show you one more time. My thumb goes over the top, down and under. And then I'm going to slide the tip of my needle up through here. I can pinch it between my thumb and forefinger, and then I'm going to knit it. And then the loop that I have that's on my thumb, I'm just going to lift up and over the top of that needle. And that's created one stitch. Then I pull on the tail end. I don't ever pull on the working yarn end, otherwise the stitches will end up too tight, and we don't want that, especially on the hat. On a hat band. So again, my thumb goes over the top, round and under. I put my needle up through there. I can pinch it just to hold it stable. I knit, and then the loop that I have in my right on my thumb, I put over the top of the needle, and I pull on the tail yarn. Again. Okay, so when you have your required 88 stitches on, we're ready to start with a 2x2 rib, which is a knit 2, purl 2, knit 2, purl 2. And so we have to join our stitches up together. So we have to make sure that the stitches aren't twisted on our needle. So a good way to do that is to make sure that the edge of the cast on is along the inside row and not twisted around. We don't want something like this, I'll show you. We don't want it to look like that, okay? Or around like that. So you're going to make sure that it lies flat. The cast on edge is lying flat on the inside, right around like this. So for magic loop, we need to make sure that both needle tips will be facing the right or pointing to the right like this. So we take roughly halfway, or since we're doing a 2x2 rib, you can count your stitches to half of that. So I'll go 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 22, 6, 8, 32, 4, 6, 8, 42, 4. So this is roughly halfway. Now I'm going to just pull my cable through this all the way through so that my stitches end up, and it can be a little tight to start off with because it's the cast on stitches, so that my stitches end up parallel on both needles like this. Now again, we want to check that they're not twisted. So you can see the cast on edge is straight here and goes straight, and on the inside there. So you can see that there's no twist. We also make sure that the tail end is out of our way. We don't want to start knitting with that. And the working yarn is attached to the needle at the back, not the needle at the front. So that's our starting position always with magic loop. So we hold it like that, and we're going to start, this is the working yarn here, and it's going to continue on and knit down here. So what we have to do is pull out this needle long like this, and then turn it around like this. Okay, and join this wool to here. So the first thing we're going to do is knit to. So I'm actually going to keep it at the front like this and knit to. Now you've got to be careful here. You don't want to pull too tight, but also not leave it too loose. So I'm going to knit to. Then I'm going to put my working yarn underneath the needle to the front. Remember, don't just do that or you'll make a stitch. And purl two. Around to the back of the fabric. Knit two. And then purl two. Knit two. And purl two. Okay, so I'm going to continue along here, and when I finish there, I'll show you how I get around to there. So I'm almost to the end. I've got knit two, purl two. Okay, then I've come to where my loop was, and what I'm going to do is turn my needles around back to that position again, where so the working yarn is on the needle towards the back. I'm going to pull this cable through. So it's always a little bit stiff to start off with. We've got the stitches lining up parallel together. The needles are pointing to the right. My working yarn is on the needle... further away, and now I'm going to continue to knit to rib along here. So I have to pull this needle out and around like this. My last two stitches were purl, and now I have to knit. So I have to make sure that it's going to be, that's right. Okay, so now I'm going to continue making sure that it's tight enough but loose enough. This is a bit of a judgment thing here. So knit two. Purl two, and I'll continue along here. Okay, so I'm getting to the end again. I've got a knit two and a purl two. Okay, so I've purled right down to the end of my cable. I'm going to turn it around. Let's put my ball of wool through the cable there. Turning it around like this so the working yarn is on the behind needle. And I'm going to pull this needle through. That's it. Like that. And make sure that I've got that starting position always. So I've got both needles pointing to the right and the working yarn attached to the needle at the back. And then I pull the back needle out and I go around. So I did two purl stitches. I'm up to a knit stitch. Now I can make it a little tighter. You have to be careful on the first round, but you have to make sure here that that's not going to have a big gap. And so I continue. I've done my 2x2 rib now for 24 rows, and that's because I want a cuff or a band that's going to turn up. So if you want to do it less than that and just have it very fitted, then you don't have to do such a long cuff. Now, as we're following the Susan B. Anderson modifications, she says in the first row of the pattern, which is just a simple stocking stitch in the same colour, she tells you to increase two stitches. We have 88 stitches and we're going to increase to 90. And she suggests that you do an increase at the beginning of the row and one halfway along, and a knit through the front and the back loop is an increase that she uses. So this is also the time now to change up to your larger size needles. I was on a 4mm and I'm changing up to a 4.5mm. So I'm just going to show you how to do that. You just simply knit on to your new needle. Okay, so I will knit a stitch and now I'm going to do my increase on the second stitch. So that's a knit through the front loop. My stitch wasn't on my needle correctly. Knit through the front loop. And then instead of taking it off, I turn the tip of the needle, right-hand needle around, knit through the back loop, and there I go. So there's my normal stitch, and there's my increase stitch there. Okay, and it's got like a little purl band underneath it. So now I'm going to stocking stitch, which, when you're knitting in the round, that just means you continually knit right around to about halfway through, and I'll do that increase stitch again, and I'll show you again one more time very slowly. Okay, so I've got to the end here and I can just simply pull this needle through. So I've still got my magic loop position. That's my smaller size, that's my bigger size. Both points are facing to the right and my yarn is attached to the needle at the back. Let's get my tail out the way. Okay, so now I pull this needle out and around and I'm going to continue to knit. So I'll knit one stitch and now I will do my increase in this stitch, and I'm going to show you again slowly. So I put my needle up and through the front loop, the front and back loop. This is the front loop of the stitch. That's the back loop. That's all that means. So, in through the front loop, don't take it off the left-hand needle, put the tip around, in through the back loop like that, knit it, whoops, and now take it off. And you can see the column of knit stitches goes up to my original stitch, and right next to it is the increased stitch with its pearl band. Okay, so I continue to knit to the end, and that'll be my first row of the pattern. I've enlarged the chart so it's very easy to read. We have now 90 stitches on our needle, and the chart has 60 stitches in it in total. So what we need to do is knit, and we're always going to read from right to left. So we're going to knit one full round or row of the chart, then start at the beginning and knit again the first 30. So Susan tells you to draw a line, and you might hopefully see my line here. I've just done that in biro, after 30 stitches, so that your eye catches it and you don't have to keep counting. So you will do the 60 stitches along, and each little box is a stitch, represents a stitch, and it's all going to be in stocking stitch, and this tells us that we're still on the same colour as we knitted the ribbing in. So we're going to do 60 stitches along and then another 30. Then we'll come back to our stitch marker or the beginning of the row, and we'll start again here, and we'll be bringing on the second row, we'll be introducing our white colour or light colour, contrast colour, whatever you've picked. And so we will knit along here for 60 stitches and then back again on row 2 for 30. And then the third row, we will start here, and that's just a straight in the original colour, and then back again for 30. So that's what we're going to be doing for every row. We're now going to start knitting. It's a good idea to use one of these little sticky sheets of paper and just mark where you're up to so that your eye will quickly go there. Now, obviously, it's not as long. If you've got one that's as long as that, then that's excellent. But just even having a short one like that enables you to quickly put your eye to the row you're at. So we're up to row 2 now, and we're going to be introducing the light colour. So for me, that's this cream. So I've got my two needles pointing to the right. I'm going to bring out my back needle, and I'm ready. And when I read it, the first two stitches are in the green, and then I bring in the white. But I'm already going to start holding my white, and I'm going to weave in my tail as I go. So later on, I won't have to weave in this edge. So I'm going to hold it at the back of the knitting like this, just with my fingers. And I'm going to start with a knit stitch. That's knit one and knit two. And I'm going to hold both yarns in my right hand until I finished weaving in. Now I'm up to a knitting one of the cream colour. And the pattern is two green, one cream, two green, one cream, all the way through to I'm finished. So now I'm up to the green colour, and I'm going to just, you can see with the tail end of the cream, I've got it over the top of my forefinger and I'm holding it down with my other fingers in place. Whoa, my needles have just fallen out. There we go. So I'm ready to knit back to where we started. So I've got two green, one cream, and now I'm ready to knit to green again. So I'm going to put my stitch in through here as to knit, and then also underneath the cream tail, which is pulled over my finger. I'm going to drop the cream yarn, pick up the green yarn, and knit it. Okay, so you'll see that that tail is now going over the top. I've got another green stitch to knit, so I'm just going to knit this one normally. And you'll see already that tail has started to be woven in. And I'm going to continue to do this once with my needle going underneath that, once normal. So I'll alternating that. And then you'll find that your stitches have been, that your tail ends are woven in. So now I'm up to the cream stitch. I'll put it in and under. And I pick up the cream yarn and I knit it. And I drop it. And I'm up for the green. Now you have to use your discretion here. And I want this green to go over the top of that tail. So I'm actually also going to knit under there for that one. And then the second one, I will knit without putting my needle underneath the cream tail. So that continues to be woven. Then I'm ready for my cream again. And I'm going to put it also underneath. So I put my needle into the knit stitch and underneath and knit it. And then drop it, pick up the green. And I'm going to stick it underneath the cream. And then knit a normal green. And I'm ready, pick up the cream, stick it underneath. Put the green underneath once, next one, just normal. So I'm nearly at the end, so I'm just holding it now between two fingers. Underneath. Underneath. And one more time over the top. Okay, and if I turn my work around, you'll see that the end has been woven in. So all I need to do later on is just cut off that edge and I don't have to weave that in. So now I've got my two balls of yarn. I will have one colour on one side and one ball on the right side. And then my balls of yarn are not going to get tangled up. So I will knit English style with my right hand and knit continental with my left. So this is how I tension for continental. I put it round my little finger like this, up and over my fourth finger, and then across my second finger like this. I'm going to show you again. So my little finger goes under and around and then nochmal up. Sorry, I'm just speaking German. And then again up to the top, over. You know, I'm speaking German because I think of this as the German method. Then over the top of the fourth finger and then across my second finger. So that's ready there. And I just like to slip that behind my ring. My right hand's ready here, and now I'm ready. As you can see, it's a cream stitch in two greens, so I'm ready to knit my cream stitch and then a green one and then a cream one and two green ones and then a cream one and two green ones. Now, I don't like to have to keep going slowly and making sure that my stitches are really even here so that it's not going to pucker. So I continue to do the weaving that I showed you earlier, and that way I can end up knitting fast and don't have to think about it. So I will do my first cream one, and then for my green one, I will knit a normal green one, and the second green one, I will stick it underneath the cream like that. And so I've caught it under here. It's going to travel, and I know it's not going to be a float which will be too tight. It's already going to be caught. And now I'm ready for the cream stitch, and then I need a green one. And under the second green one, I stick my needle also underneath the cream yarn and knit it. And then cream, knit one green one normal, knit one green one with the point underneath the cream yarn. I love colour work. I just love working with two colours. All the more joy. Okay, so we've knitted there and we do what we have to do with magic loop. Turn it around like this. Have both ends of the needles facing that way. Pull the back one out and we're ready to start. So we're ready to start with the cream. Here my yarn is a little bit tangled, so I just have to put all that over here. I've actually never done magic loop with coloured before. I've always used DPNs, so I'm learning this with you. Okay, so we've got two green ones here, and we're up to the cream one. Now, when you're going around a corner, you do have to be careful that you're not going to pull too tight or be too loose. So there's my stitch here. So you can often just hold your hand flat like this to make sure that those stitches are going to be flat, and then you know you haven't pulled too tight or too loose, and I'm ready to go on. So one green, normal, and then put the tip underneath the cream. And then underneath the cream. Just turn my needle around like that. Cream, green, and then under the tip. Cream, green, under the tip. I'm going to continue to the end. Okay, so I've entered with a cream, and if I go along number two, so I would have done the second line all the way for 60 stitches, gone back and done another 30, and I'm correct. I've ended with a white. And as you can see, the pattern goes on perfectly. Two green, one cream, two green, one cream. Now, the third row is simply just using the green all the way around. So I can drop this cream and just leave it, okay, because the fourth row I'll be using it every second stitch again. So I don't want to cut off the end and rejoin it. I'll just continue it up. So you're ready for your second row, and I'll see you on the fourth row. We're up to row four now, and we have to start using our cream colour again. So I'm going to show you again how I tension the yarn. I put my little finger underneath and around twice. Probably the easiest way to say it. So around twice, like that. Then it goes up over the top of my ring finger, underneath my third finger, and across my second. And I'm holding it like that. Okay, so if we look at our fourth row, it's just alternating a green stitch, a cream stitch, a green stitch, a cream stitch. So I don't actually need to weave in because I don't have consecutive stitches of the same colour. So I make sure that I start with a green stitch, although I probably will weave in just on the first because I want to make sure that I'm not going to have anything loose here. Okay, so That's my first green stitch and now my cream stitch. Then my green and my cream. One green, one cream, one green, one cream. And what you'll notice is when you look down on the right side, this is what's great about doing Fair Isle in the round, is you'll always have the pattern side in front of you, and then you can get to see what does the pattern look like. And so you'll see that either side of the first cream stitch, you're going to have another cream stitch, and then over the next one, you'll have a cream stitch over the top of it, and then either side of that cream stitch, you'll have two. If you get used to picking up patterns like that, you'll find you'll be able to check yourself all the time as you're going, and you'll pick up a mistake much quicker and therefore not have to undo so much if you do a mistake. So just get used to looking for patterns. So I'll just go slowly again. I knit the green with my right hand and the cream with my left. So I'm picking the cream. I put my needle in and I turn it from the right underneath. So I'm going over the top and underneath like that, picking it and then pulling it through. So I'm picking with my left wool and throwing with my right. I'll knit slowly for you for a bit so you can see that. And make sure that you let the thread or the yarn feed through in a relaxed manner, feed through your fingers in a relaxed manner. And try to feel that the yarn in both hands is feeding through in the same tension. So that your stitches will be even no matter what hand the yarn has come from. So continue on row 4 with this pattern, and then again we'll have one row of green, and that's where I will show you how to weave in this cream edge. We're up to row 5, and that's a knit row with just the green wool. Then we've got 1, 2, 3, we've got 3 rows without the cream. So I think that we can just break the cream off and darn it in. So I'm going to show you how to do that. So here I'm just going to leave a tail of about that much. So I will have it like this, again, threaded through my fingers over the top. And I'm going to weave it in as I knit this single row of green stitch. Okay. So you always have to be careful at these crossover points to see that your stitches are not going to be pulled too tight or too loose. So sometimes just holding your thumb, pinching your fabric straight like that underneath and then knitting one stitch like that, that's going to help you keep it even. I always think it's better to be slightly on the tight side than the loose side. Okay, so now I'm just going to simply be working my green yarn, but every alternate stitch, I'm going to put the tip through the stitch and underneath the white tail. And this one I'll just stitch normally underneath the white tail, stitch normally. And then the tip goes underneath the white tail and I knit both the tail and the stitch together. Knit normally, underneath the tail. Knit normally, So I've done it for quite a few stitches now. You can do it for varying lengths. You don't want to feel that all of your tails end here. So one, you might do at least 6 stitches, but one you might do a bit longer, one a little bit thinner, because it will add extra thickness to the fabric, not enough that you'd really notice a big or that it's a big deal. Okay, so under and over, under and over, and you can see there it is there, it's woven in beautifully, and you don't have to do it at the end. That's the exciting bit. So you can just cut that off. You can do it now or you can do it at the end. Actually, I like to do it at the end because then I can modify if any stitches are a little loose or tight by pulling this. So that's something you can finish to do at the end. So you're going to continue with row 5 in green, and then we're going to introduce the legs of the sheep. We're up to row 6 and now I'm introducing the legs of the sheep, and I'm going to be using black. So I'm going to start, like I showed you, with the cream wool, my tail in between my fingers, with the end coming over the top here. Okay, so the pattern is 2 green, 1 black, 1 green, 1 black, and then 5 green. So I just hold it under my forefinger for now. I start off with my 2 green, and now I'm ready for my black. And while I'm weaving in a new end, I'm only going to have both yarns in my right hand. So I've got 1 black, and then I have a green, and I've got that tail end of my black over my finger, and I'm going to slip the tip of my finger underneath again to start the weaving process. And then I put down the green, I've got my black, I'm also going to, you can see and judge whether you need to go under or not with the tip. So this one I'm also going to go under with the tip. So that's the first 2 feet. And now I've got 5 green. So I'm going to drop my black and I'm going to do 1. And then I'm going to put the tip underneath for 2, and then I'm going to knit 3 normally, and then I want to catch, 5 is a lot of stitches for me, I like to have everything woven in, so I'm going to put my black over the top, so I've got my tail and my working yarn over there, and I'm going to knit the 4th stitch with the, and putting the tip underneath like that. And then I'm going to pull out my working yarn so it's free again. And that way I've caught both this and woven in the tail at the same time. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 green stitches. I have 1 last green stitch. And now I'm ready for the black. So I put my needle in and also underneath the tail and I knit my black. Okay, and now I've got 2 green stitches. I put the black down. I'm going to put the tip underneath the tail, and the next one I'll knit normally, and then this is going to be caught there. And I'm up for another black foot, so I'm going to put it underneath, pick up the next, my black yarn, and knit that. So that's my next sheep's feet. And I'm ready for another 5 green. So under I go for 1, a normal stitch for 2. I might go, I can also catch here as well. So I put over my real yarn with my tail of the black, put under both of them, knit it, and then knit another one. I've got 4 stitches on. I take back my working black yarn, leave the tail still over the finger. I have one more green stitch to do and I'm going to stick it underneath the tail. So I've got 5 green stitches and I'm ready for another black foot. So I'm just going to knit that one normally. Put the tip under the tail for the green stitch in between. And now I'm ready. And I can see here that the tail's going over and I need to trap it like that. If I was to put it underneath this time, I wouldn't be trapping it. So that you'll get used to. You just have to, you have to check that you're doing it correctly. Okay. So there I've and you'll see that my black tail is woven in. Okay. So I won't have to do that later on. I'll just snip it off here. So now I'm ready to put my black yarn in my left hand and my green stays in my right hand. So I tension the yarn for picking. Okay, so I have to remember, where am I in my pattern? Okay, so I've got one sheep, that's my second sheep. I've got 5 in between. This is the front feet of the third sheep. And I've got 2 green to go. So one on the second one, I just stick it underneath that, 2. And then I've got a black foot for the hind feet, 1 in between. The second hind foot, that's my third sheep done. And now I've got 5 green ones in between. So I will do 1. And on every second one, I'm going to stick my tip under the black yarn. And that's just going to carry it along nicely for me so I don't have to worry about tensioning and it's going to be perfectly there and I won't have a float. Have a look at that. I'm not going to have any float. I don't have to worry about floats. Okay, and now I'm ready to use it for my fourth sheep. That's his first leg, 1 in between. His second leg, and I have another 5. So if I go again, I knit 1, the second one, the tip goes underneath the black yarn, the third one's normal, fourth one, tip underneath, and fifth one, and I'm up for my 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth first leg of the sheep. Okay, so that's how you do it. When I turn it around, you'll see I've got no floats. Everything's beautifully woven in. These are just the tails, which I'll go and cut off later. So continue with rows 6 and 7 and with row 8, with row 8 and 9 and 10, you've got longer stretches of the cream and make sure that you weave in those colours. I'll show you one more time when we get to about row 8 or 9. We're up to row 8 now and we won't be using the black yarn anymore or the colour that you've got for the sheep's feet, and we will be introducing the cream colour back in again for the sheep. Now, there's only going to be 3 rows until we'll be needing the same colour as the sheep's for the feet and the head, so in my case, the black. So I'm not going to cut it off. I'm just going to leave the ball up directly in front of me, and later I will just simply pull the yarn over the 3 rows and start with it again here. So it'll be like a float going in this direction instead of that direction. So I'll leave that one there and I'm going to introduce my cream yarn just like we did the others. I'm going to put it over my hand or thread it over my left hand and weave in the end as I work. So the pattern says 2 of the green and 3 of the sheep's body. So I will start here. I'm got one, two, and now I'm going to start with my three from the sheep's body, and I'm going to put my finger now underneath the tail of the green, and the next one I'm going to put the tip of the needle underneath and catch it. And now I can also put across the green over there like that, so that you can see I'm going to catch with my cream thread my green yarn. So that's for the third. And then I drop the cream, get my green back again, keep the tail of the cream over because I'm going to be continuing to weave that in. And I now have five of the green. So I will start, it's one, second one, under, two, three. Now I'm going to put my needle underneath the tail of the cream and also put my working yarn of the cream over the top so I catch both of them in, knit it. I've got one, two, three, four green on my right hand, right needle. Now I've knitted the fifth one. I can drop that and I'm ready. See, they're caught in there. You can see how those stitches there have caught over the top. And I've got five green. I'm ready to work with my cream. And I have four cream stitches. So go over once. The next one I'll weave underneath the tail. Three. Now I don't like to leave a float longer than three. So I'm going to put my green over the top. Put the tip underneath and knit. There's my four stitches and I'm ready for the green. Okay, green has five again. One underneath for two. Over the top for three. Now I'm nearly at the end of my tail, underneath, and I'm also going to put the cream over the top as well to catch that. That's four, five. Okay, so now there's my tail. It's woven in the back here. I'll later on cut that off. So I'm ready now to put my right, and I can sometimes tangle up your wool just a little bit doing that, but now I keep my cream wool on my left-hand side and my green wool on my right-hand side, and I'm ready to keep going. Okay, so I've done five here, and then my pattern says, what have I got, 2, 4, 6, 8. Eight of the sheep's body. So this is where the sheep is standing on the side. So I'll do one, and then the next one I'm going to put underneath. No, sorry, I've got to think again. I'm going to knit two, and now I'm going to catch this thread as I go. So because it's in the right hand, what I need to do is I wrap it around as if I'm going to knit it. You see this here? I'm going to wrap it around as if I'm going to knit it. And then I'm going to wrap the cream wool around, and then I'm going to wrap the green wool back. And then I knit the stitch. I'm thinking music. And it's caught. So that's three. Then I'll do four, five, and I'm going to do it again. So this is how you catch the float if you're not the float from the right hand. So I go around as if I'm from right to left, as if I'm going to knit. Then with my needle, I go as if I'm going to pick knit. So right around the back like that. And now I take my green wool back the direction that I came, and then I knit it. 2, 4, 6, 7. I'll show you one more time here. I wouldn't need to, but I'll just show you. So the green wool goes under the needle, and then from left to right, the white wool goes over the top, and then I go back the way I came, and then I pull this through. 2, 4, 6, 8. So I've got all of the stitches I need for the body of the sheep, and now I've got 5 green stitches to do. So it's 1, a normal one. Now I'm going to stick it underneath. That's 3, 4, and 5. And I'm up to 3 white ones. So I go 1, 2, and then I'm going to, I don't want any more than 2 really. So I go to knit, and then I go to knit, and then I undo this one again, and I pull it through. And there's a 3 for the sheep's body, and I've got another 5 to do. So always I'm going to stick my needle point underneath the white on alternate ones. That's 1, knit 1 normal, 2, knit 1 under, 3, knit 1 normal, 4, knit 1 under, 5. Okay, and I'm up to 4 white ones. So here's my 1. And I'm going to turn my magic loop around like this. Pull the stitches so both of them are facing the right. Pull out the back one. Continue, so I get my cream wool in my left hand, my green wool in my right hand. I have to make sure I remember where I am in the pattern. So that was 3. And this is a group of 4 white stitches. I've done my first white stitch. So my second white stitch, whoopsie, and I'm going to hold it pretty tight. Now, to keep this tight, I'm going to join that wool like I did before, around, back again, so I've caught the green one in, and that's going to help me keep this relatively tight. And one more cream one, so now I've got 4. And I'm ready for 5 green ones again. So, 1, second one, under, third one, normal, fourth one, under, fifth one, normal. And now I have 8 white ones again. So I'm going to show you this. First of all, I just do a normal white stitch. Now I can do 2 of them. Now it's time for me to catch my green wool. So I put my needle in, I go to knit it, I go round. So basically, your right hand wool is going from right to left underneath. Your left hand wool is going from left to right over the top. Your right hand wool is going from left to right underneath, and then you pull through. So what I'm doing is I'm just catching it. See how it's caught there? Okay. So if I do that fast, I'll show you slow again. You don't need to see it fast. You just probably need to see it a few times slow. So that's 3, 4, 5. And I'm going to catch my wool again. So in goes the needle. The green wool is like I knit it, and then that's like I would knit. The white wool is like I would knit it continental style. Then I take the green wool back, reverse the way it came, and then pull the stitch through. 2, 4, 6, 7. I'll do it one more time. 8. And now I've got another 5 green to do. 5, and I'm weaving behind. And look, already you can see how neat that is. There's no floats. So continue along with rows 8, 9 and 10, and then I'll show you how I bring the black loop up. And then I think I've taught you everything you need to know until we start the decreases. So we're up to row 11 now, and we're going to finish with this colour that we've used on the ribbing band and around where the sheep's feet are. So for me, that's this colour green. Okay, and we're going to bring back, because we need to do the sheep's faces, we're going to bring back the colour that we used for the legs, and for me that's black. So if I turn my work inside, you can see that's where I last left my black yarn, and I'm just going to bring that up like that over here, making sure it's not pulled really tight, but also not really loose, otherwise my first stitch is going to be sloppy, but just like that. And we're going to end this green yarn. So we don't need it anymore. I'm going to cut it off. That was such a pretty colour. It's a shame to end it. And I'm going to thread it around my left hand and I'm going to weave it in. So I will show you that. So for now, we just simply have both of our main working colours on our right hand. And we start reading the pattern. Row 11, I need to do 3 white stitches and then 1 black, 3 white, 1 black, 3 white. Okay, so here's my white stitch, 1, and now I'm going to put the end in underneath here. That's 2. Now I also want to bring in my black, and so this is a good opportunity to put my black stitch over there as well. And just hook it in, okay? So it's already hooked there, you can see, and then I make sure that it's just smoothly over the top. Let me put it there. Smoothly over the top. Not too tight, that would be too tight, not too loose, just like that. So that's caught now, and I'm ready to use it for 1 stitch. And then I drop it. I've got 3 more white stitches. So I put the tip underneath the tail end of the green and knit 1 normally underneath the tail end of the green. And then I'm ready for another black stitch. So I just always at the beginning, I'm just checking, is everything okay? Yeah, that's good. That's nice tension there. And that bring that around. Now that's really the longest float I'm going to have. I don't like long floats, so I'm not going to have it any longer than that. Okay, so I've got 3, 1 black, 3 cream, 1 black. I need another 3 cream. So I'll put it underneath the tail and then do a normal one. And now this time I'm also going to hook in my black. So I put it over there. Put the tip of the needle under both, bring back my black, and I'm ready for, I've now got 2, because this is a bit of a bigger sheep. He has 2, so I've knitted 1, the next one goes underneath the green, his face is a bit wider. I drop it. Now here I can see this stitch is just going to be a little fat, and I don't want that. So I'm just making sure that that's nice and even along here. Okay, and I have another 3 white ones. So 1 underneath, 3, and then I have a single black one. You just go a little bit slowly at first when you're weaving in as well. Oops, I've got underneath here, single black one. Drop it. And now I've got 2 more cream. and another big-faced sheep. So that takes two. I'm going to put it underneath for one, over the top for two. And then I've got, I need more wool. Then I've got 2, 4, 6, 8 white ones. So 1, 2. Now I'm going to, I've nearly woven in. I don't even need to weave this in so far, but I'm going to. So I'm just keep it there and I'm going to add my black so I catch that at the same time. So I put my needle in here and underneath both of those and knit underneath them and then once on top. Okay, so now I can let that green one go. He's been beautifully woven in underneath here. Later I'll just snip him off with the scissors. And I can go back to having my yarn in separate hands. So I'm going to put my cream yarn in my left hand with a ball of wool on the left side and my black yarn now over here. So I had to, let me just recount, I had to do 3, 6, 8. So that's, I've got 4, I need to do 4 more. So that's 1. Now, remember, I'm going to carry my black yarn, thread it through. So I do it once like that, over the top with the cream, back around with the black and over. So it's 2, 4, 6, 7, and I'll do it one more time. As if I'm going to knit over the top with the cream, back underneath with the black. I keep forgetting how many stitches I've done. 2, 4, 6, 8. Okay, and I think that's right. And now I need to do a 1 black stitch and 3 cream. So I'll just put my black one in there, hook it through. A black one, 3 cream. And on the third cream, I'm just hooking my float. I really don't like floats to be longer than 2 stitches. Otherwise, I have to think about how even am I doing it. And then I'm ready for 2. What am I ready for? I'm ready. I'm going to have to count this. All this talking, I've kind of forgotten where I am. 1 more black. And 3 white. And particularly if I'm on the last stitch, I'm wanting to catch this black so I know the tension's going to be fine. Okay, and I'm ready to go on. So as you can see, I'll turn this inside out and you can see through here, it's very neat. There's no long floats. You've only got these tail ends which you'll just snip off at the end. Okay, so I want you to continue on following the pattern. I've showed you how to do everything, how to introduce a new colour, how to weave in the ends that you're finishing and that you're starting. So you need to continue up until you've finished row 25. And then we're going to do a different decrease based on Susan B. Anderson's. And I'll talk you through that. The decrease rounds in the pattern start on round 26. So if you're following exactly the pattern as written, you will need to decrease by knitting 2 together on every one of these squares that has a slash in it. But if you're following Susan B. Anderson's modifications, as I have been, she's written out exactly what to do for the last 18 rows of the hat. So she's written out both how to do the decreases and how to continue in the pattern. And she writes MC, and that stands for main colour, and that'll be the background colour of the sky that you're using. And her CC stands for contrast colour, and that's the colour of the snowflakes. So row 26 of the chart becomes her round 1. And you'll be decreasing with her modifications on almost every alternate row. Not exactly, though. Her instructions are extremely clear and easy to follow, but I just want to show you what to do on round 13. So after round 12, Susan says to cut the contrast colour and only work in the main colour for the last five rounds of the pattern to the end of the hat. And I want to show you now how to weave in the tail end of the contrast colour. So we can see the pattern's coming on really nicely now. And round 13 is knit three and then knit two together. So I've cut off my contrast colour. My contrast colour was the cream for the snowflakes. And I'm going to hold it in my left hand, like the continental. I've got my main colour here. I'm going to slip the tip of my needle underneath. So I knit one. I knit it normally. Two. I put the tip underneath. Knit three. And then I'm going to knit two together. Okay, so I'm going to weave in this end. Knit one, knit two, and again I put the tip underneath, knit three, knit two together. And this way I've got no ends to weave in apart from my tail that I cast on with. So again, under one, the middle one I knit normally. Under again for three, knit two together. So then if I turn it around, you can see the tail is woven in. I'll just do it one more. So knit one underneath, knit two, knit one underneath again, and knit two together. Okay, so now I can cut off this end. And continue knitting around. And I want to show you how well it's going to look. So already it's very neat. And everything's already woven in for you. Okay, so continue on now. It's pretty easy. You follow the pattern exactly. Finish off the rows. You're only knitting with the main colour now to the end, and then we're going to thread through the yarn for the last nine stitches and make a pom-pom. So I'll see you right at the end. We've got our nine stitches on at the end, and now we're going to thread. I've cut off the wool, and we're going to thread the tail end through all of these stitches. So I'm just threading it through pearlwise. Okay. So I'm going to pull it all together tight, like this. Then I'm going to turn it inside out. So I'm going to put my needle through first, like this. Turn it inside out. And just make a fastening stitch. So I'll put it through there and then put my needle through. I might do this a couple of times to make sure that it's really secure. Okay, and then I'll just weave my end in. So I'm just weaving it in through the pearly bumps. Like this. Do it a bit more. I always do perhaps a little bit more than is necessary. Stretch it out so it's not going to be puckering. And then I'll cut off that tail end. And we've just got this end here. And you want to join that to this stitch here across like that to make this a nice edge. So with this technique of... So I'm just going to go in through that's my original first stitch. And then back again. So it's nice and straight. So this technique of Fair Isle, where you're weaving in the ends as you start new colours and end, that wasn't so good, I'll take that one out there, means that when you finish your work, you only have your end tail and beginning tail to weave in. Okay, so that's nice and straight there. And I'll just weave this down along here. Okay, so I do it a little bit more. I might go right to the full length of my ribbing. Then I know it's not going to come out. And I cut off my tail. Okay, so now you're ready to block it. So I suggest that you put it in, let it soak for about 15 minutes in some lukewarm water. So that's water that you'd be happy to put a baby in. So not too cold or not too hot, certainly not too hot. And if it's too cold, it shocks the wool as well. Let it have a good soaking so that the fibre is full of wool, water. And then when you're squeezing the water out, you don't want to be wringing. So you're never going to do this. You can just gently squeeze the water out like this, and then you get a towel, you lay it flat, and you wrap it up like this in your towel. And when it's completely wrapped up in your towel, then you can stand on it, and the weight of your body will squeeze the excess water. And I just sort of tread like this, slowly over the top, and the weight will squeeze the excess water into the towel. And then it'll be damp and you can put it on top of a balloon. I'll show you that. So we've put him on our balloon head. And there he is. And then that gives it a nice round surface for it to dry on. To make a pom-pom, get two pieces of cardboard that are relatively flimsy, but not too flimsy. Put them together and outline a circle. My outside circle, the diameter is 7.5 centimetres or 3 inches. And the inside circle is about 2.5 centimetres or 1 inch. So the outside or circle diameter determines how big your pom-pom is going to be, and how thick it is measured by how big your hole in here is. So if you fill it up with wool very, very thickly, it'll be a thicker pom-pom. So you put in between, you get a piece of yarn about this length, and you're going to put it around like this, and you've got a little slit there so that the wool can get through. And then you put your other one on top. And then we're going to start wrapping the yarn right around the circle, back and forward, back and forward, until this here in the inside is going to be thick. I'm going to have a two-toned pom-pom, so I'm using this soft blue and soft cream together. So I'm just going to put it here and hold it with my thumb. Later on, I won't need to hold it because it'll be wrapped underneath other wool. And then I put this through. It's going to be a little annoying with this here, but you just have to work around it. In the end, we're going to pull these two tight. So that's why we need to have it there. And that's going to secure the pom-pom. So I've made mine a pretty thick pom-pom. The next thing I'm going to do is take these two ends and tie them together. So I can tie them together in there and tie them really tightly. As tight as I can. Okay. So that should secure the wool. And now I have to get my scissors and separate between these two cardboard pieces and slowly cut all of the wool around the edge here. But the strands of wool would be held tightly by these middle string. So just do this very slowly. If it's very thick like this, it'll take a little while to get through. Okay, I've cut all the way around the outside. Now, just to make sure that it's going to be really, really solid, I'm going to tie it and I'm going to put two strands through. So I'm going to thread this down through and around one more time. And tie this. Center in a knot, really pull it tight as you can. And again, good. And now we can just simply slip this cardboard out. And there we have our beautiful little pom-pom. We can give it a bit of a shake like this to fluff it out a bit more. And then you can give it a trim. Okay, so you might take a little bit off this side. And we have our beautiful little pom-pom, which we can sew on our hat. Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope you had a great time learning how to do the two-handed ferrule technique on this gorgeous Baa-ble hat. I would love to see pictures of your finished hat. So if you'd like to post some pictures, you can do so on Ravelry, at my Fruity Knitting podcast group, or on Instagram, you can hashtag me with Fruity Knitting, and on Facebook, I'm also Fruity Knitting. So if you've enjoyed this video, please subscribe because I have regular knitting podcasts and technique and tutorial videos.